Okay. So yeah, that's the campaign theme. So the hashtag for this International Women's Day, the theme hashtag is Choose to Challenge. For those of you who celebrated the International Women's Day with us last year, would remember the extravagant brunch we all had in Hilton, where we were close to each other, and we also celebrated our 10th anniversary on the day, Muslim Sisters of Eire's 10th anniversary. But the last year has taught us resilience and adaptation to our circumstances. So here we are, 1 year later, to celebrate this day and to have a look at what we have achieved and how this pandemic has brought out the best in us. We have a wonderful and very interesting lineup of speakers who will share with us their wisdom and experiences. It is a very informal setup, so feel free to sit back with your cup of tea and enjoy the next hour and a half. Just a few housekeeping before we go right in. I've put the schedule down in the chat box so you can look at who's coming in next. Everyone's muted by default, so we won't be disrupted by any latecomers or children or pets. When you want to talk during Q&A, you can just unmute yourself or raise your hand. You can also send in questions anonymously. You can have your cameras on or off, but it's nice to have it on as it's really personal and interactive, especially when you're doing an online event. It's hard to connect with people. So it's your own personal preference, really. When I'm talking or sharing my screen, you can use the chat box if you don't hear me or you don't hear what's playing. You're welcome to use the chat box throughout. Send in your questions. I will try my best to keep a close eye on the chat box. For anyone on Twitter, the hashtags we're using today is hashtag IWD2021, hashtag IWD, hashtag International Women's Day, and hashtag Choose to Challenge. So don't forget to tag us. We're at MSOE underscore Dublin on Twitter and Instagram, and Muslim Sisters of Eire on Facebook. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Maryam Sai to recite a few verses from the opening chapter of the Quran. Over to you, Jasmina and Maryam.
Thank you.
Hold on, I'll put you on camera. Hang on. Okay, good, go. Okay, you can start reading now. In Arabic and in English, go.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmanir rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladina an'amta 'alayhim. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين.
English.
Praise to be to Allah, the Lord of all the worlds, the All Merciful, the Most Merciful, the King of the Day of Repayment. You alone we worship. You alone we ask for help. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those you have blessed, not of those with anger on them, nor of them misguided. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maryam. That was absolutely wonderful. Well done. So we're 3 minutes ahead of schedule. So that's great, Lorraine. We'll give you an extra minute or something. So our first speaker for today is Lorraine O'Connor, who probably does not need an introduction, but just as a formality, born and raised in County Dublin, she's a dedicated wife and mother of four amazing daughters and a grandmother to three beautiful children. She embraced Islam in 2004 and has been serving both the Muslim community and the wider Irish society ever since. She is the chairperson of Muslim Sisters of Eire, an organization established in 2010 that has provided support and advocacy in many areas, including humanitarian aid, poverty relief, interfaith activities, integration and diversity. Lorraine will talk on the topic, Unstoppable, Love in the Time of Pandemic.
Good morning, everybody, and assalamu alaikum, sisters. What a beautiful morning, first of all. Happy International Women's Day to you all out there. When we were doing the trying to come up with a theme or a name for this morning's event, and you know, we were juggling back between, you know, back and forward. You know, we want a name that spelled strong women. We wanted a name of the time that we're living in, the pandemic at the moment. And, you know, it was either Jasmina or Aisha said, look at the love that we've been spreading in the past year. And as Aisha touched on point there, I kind of want to bring us back to March of last year. We had an amazing International Women's Day last year. we had 160 guests, and we celebrated women, and we celebrated, in celebrating women on International Women's Day, we also celebrated our 10th anniversary of the achievements that Muslim Sisters of Eire had achieved in the 10 years. And when I think back on that day, it was like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God was blessing us with our last big event, because after that, there wasn't any more. It was an amazing night. And I remember we had that event on the 10th of March, the 9th in the Hilton. And less than 10 days later, we went into lockdown. The whole country went into lockdown. And I remember thinking, like everybody else, the fear of God was in us. This plague was here. We were, you know, it was on the media. It was spreading all over the world. We were seeing horrific things happening in Italy at that time. And I was scheduled to go to Milan, to Lombardy, to see my sister-in-law. And they were smack bang in the epicenter of it. And it was like, whoa, I'm not going near you. It was like, we were all full of fear, literally full of fear. And I remember thinking, coming from an organization's perspective, we had been facilitating a super run outside the GPO back then last March. We were in our fifth year. And thinking to myself, whoa, what are we going to do? And all Muslim Sisters of Eire is known for the events that we do. We hold many events throughout the year, up 10, 12 events of different diversities and dialogues and interfaith and, you know, in multicultural days. And we're always out doing events. And I was thinking to myself, what are we going to do? I mean, no one taught that this was going to last, how long it lasts. We all thought, oh, there's got to be a vaccine around the corner and we're all going to be back out. But we were all battling with uncertainty and fear. And they were the two things that set in our hearts. What was our future? What was around the corner? And the fear of God of this pandemic coming into our house, this virus. And watching so many people being hit with it and losing loved ones. Then I remember thinking to myself, we have to do something. You know, we've got so much to give that we shouldn't just stop. There's so many families out there, and thinking of the homeless at that time back in March, we were only feeding about 250 a week. And we know that by what we buy per month and by the graft we have in the office and how we keep tags on what we're spending and how many we feed and so forth and so on. And I remember thinking to myself, 250 people, multiply that per month is 1,000 people per month we're feeding. And we're just going to close our doors on these people. How are we going to, you know, how, first of all, my conscience was just killing me. I just couldn't. I said, how are we going to do this? And then on top of that, the organization gets a lot of donations every week from Food Cloud and from different Tesco's and Dunn's. And these were being alerted every week. And every time I rejected them, that meant that food was being put in the bin and I just couldn't cope for it. So I got on and started chatting to the committee and said, we have to do something. And at that stage, everybody was working from home. Even my desktop came to the box bedroom. And come here and I tell you, talk about a trial and time. My husband works for a loan and he was this side in the box room and I'm that side working for Muslim Sisters of Eire. And it was like so difficult. But we went through it.
Is it just me or is Lorraine frozen for everybody else as well?
No, Lorraine is frozen.
Yeah, she froze.
Okay, we'll just give her a few minutes to come back. Okay, so Lorraine just said she's coming back in. So Zoom probably kicked her out. She was too excited. But yeah, like as she was going through, I think some of the committee who's here can relate to battling with the uncertainty and fear. And it was, the meetings used to be at a different level at that time. Like we wouldn't know how we'd go on from one week to the next. Sandra's saying, I'm having major internet issues. Can I express my heartfelt? Thank you so much, Sandra. Really appreciate you joining us this morning. And Lorraine is back, yay.
Back.
Welcome back, Lorraine.
Oh my God, that laptop, me, forget it. I'm back on my phone, so I'll have to deal with it this way. So, so the epicenter of Muslim Sisters of Eire became the sitting room in my house, the storage room, and the office was upstairs in the box room. And it started saying, you know, it asked the committee, if I do hampers for families and I get them ready, those of you that have cars, can you come to my driveway? And it was like an escalator. So, you know, Michelle at the Barakallah, being the women that they are, they were ready to, you know, go straight into it immediately. So we start then with hampers, and every week, oh my God, you know, my whole sitting room was just, you couldn't walk in. There was so much food. Myself and my husband did the collections on Wednesday, Thursday and Friday with my son-in-law and with my daughters. And then everything would come home into the sitting room, and then all the hampers would start getting set up. And Aisha, Michelle, put out a call on Facebook saying, never be hungry, never be alone if there's anything we can do for you. And in that little bit of compassion and that love that we wanted to do, we also found a way for dialogue and understanding between Muslims and non-Muslims. Because when I tell you the majority of hampers went out to the non-Muslim faith people, it was absolutely beautiful. And it bonded in time of need, no matter race, color, creed, gender, religion, anything. It was from a person to a person. And the hampers just were, the amount, the call and the amount of people asking for hampers just was unbelievable. And that work continued right through the year, and we're still doing the hampers. And during that time then, we start, you know, getting to be a little bit more, you know, as I say, a little bit more brave and stepping out a little bit further and doing a little bit more. We then start getting calls from isolation centres where families from the Muslim faith who obviously only eat halal food, and the isolation centres didn't have that in place for them, were ringing us and saying, we've got families, you know, they're all in the isolation centre. We don't have the food that they are used to eating. Can you help? And immediately a rota and a system came in immediately. And the sisters, you know, for 2 weeks, we were feeding a family of seven. Every single day, there was hot food sent into the isolation center in Temple Bar. And the sisters kicked in immediately. And it was that love again, that unstoppable love in the time of a pandemic, where we come together and unite and keep going with the work that we're doing. Then during Ramadan last year, it was a Ramadan that was very unique that I think we never, ever experienced. I know I didn't since I became a Muslim, but my husband, who's a born Muslim, never experienced something like it in his life, because Ramadan is the hub of community where you all go to each other's houses for breaking your fast, and then you all head on to the mosque, and then you're there in the night prayers, and the community are all together. And this last Ramadan was completely different, where you were breaking your fast in your house, you were staying in your house, no visitors, and you were doing your prayers all with your family. But also, there was such a blessing because it brought families closer as well. But we also didn't stop, where we put out a call again, remembering the children in the direct provision centres, that every single year during Eid, it's coming up to Eid, we bring gifts to them, you know, to celebrate Eid for them. And, you know, I said, we can't stop this just because of this pandemic. We have to do something. So we put out a call again, and we started our Thai drive, and I went down to Mosny with 360 gifts for children, all individually wrapped, and the community spirit that came in with these gifts was absolutely amazing. And this was from families from all walks of life giving gifts to these children. And again, that love was there, and it was there to share. And I suppose by May or June, when the numbers start dropping, we said, okay, it's time to start going back with our soup run and helping our families in the homeless. And we opened back up last June, and even in December, when we were in the peak in January, up to what, 8,000 or 9,000, we didn't shut down. We only shut down for 2 weeks because so many of us were hit with the virus. And that's because we're frontline workers. We're out there. And as I said in the beginning, we were feeding 250. 3 weeks ago, our highest count was 570 hot meals we handed out 3 weeks ago. Now, we're dealing with 570 people on a Friday night down there at the GPO. We're a huge high risk for contracting the virus. But how can we close down? How can we turn our back? How can we say no? And so many of us have been hit with this virus from being down there on Friday night. And only recently I called the HSE and I was saying, you know, you need to look at these charities that are out there. You need to up them and give them this vaccine so we can continue our work. But we were told we're not frontline workers. And I'm like, oh, the ones slapped my head against the wall and gone, you're feeding 570, you know, forgotten people every week. And you're saying we're not frontline workers. Okay. And I mean, it's that, again, that unstoppable love, that strive to keep going, that strive to keep continuing to help people to the stage that people now know. And right through the past year, just been, when I say our phone has been inundated with families calling us for help, we can't get out, we have the virus, we're all stuck in. Can you get me a basic packet of paracetamol for 250 we were asked to get. And yet no sister has ever denied that right and said, oh, we're here, 250, I'm not going down to get a chemist. Immediately, a kick in and straight out to the chemist, straight out to get everything that these families need. And I'm talking, again, not only about Muslim families, I'm talking about non-Muslim families as well. So when I look back on this year of the pandemic, and I speak, I know, on behalf of all of Muslim Sisters of Eire, I'm going to wrap up with this now, is that we have been so privileged. We all had fear in our hearts, and we all, you know, didn't know what was in front of us. The whole road was cloudy, it was dark, and we didn't know. But when we look back on this year, with every lesson, and the pandemic has been a big lesson to us all, there is a blessing. And it has been a blessing that we have been able to show that love, that empathy, that compassion that we strive as Muslim Sisters of Eire to do and will continue to do. So I'm getting the kind of nudge there, wrap up, Lorraine, your 10 minutes is up. So I hope that kind of gives you an insight to that unstoppable love that Muslim Sisters of Eire is about. And thank you so much and enjoy the rest of the morning. Okay, Aisha.
Thank you so much, Lorraine. That was very inspiring, and we're so proud to be a part of this team. It really touched us where you said that we all had that fear of the pandemic in our hearts, but we've been privileged to pass on that love and pass on the compassion. Some lovely comments coming in the comment box, but you guys can have a read there. I'm just going to introduce our next speaker. It is my pleasure to welcome our special guest, Minister of Justice, Helen McEntee. Helen McEntee, TD, is the Minister for Justice. She was appointed in this role in June 2020. She previously served on the Erectus Committee on Transport and Communications and was also a member of the Committee on Environment, Culture and Gaeltacht. Helen will be speaking on the topic, is the empowerment of migrant women important? Over to you, Helen.
Good morning, Aisha, and good morning, everyone. Thank you sincerely for inviting me to join you this morning and to celebrate International Women's Day. And just if I could start by wishing everyone a happy International Women's Day. I'm really delighted that this as a day, it really has gained in prominence and something that has strengthened over the years. It's a pity that I can't join you in person, but obviously we're in the scenario we're in at the moment, but it's great that we can join by Zoom. I don't have any children or pets, so they won't be coming in. I do have a husband, but he's been warned to stay outside, so we shouldn't have any interruptions. But, you know, look, this really is a day for us to celebrate the wonderful women in our lives. And I think to celebrate the women who have supported us, who have nurtured us, who have helped make us the people who we are today. And that's everyone from our mothers, our grandmothers, our sisters, our friends, our work colleagues, our community, but also the women that we don't know and the women we've never met, but who have been so instrumental in shaping the society that we live in today, those who have broken many of the glass ceilings and those who continue to break glass ceilings. And I see my colleague and Senator Flynn on the line, and so many other wonderful women in politics who are breaking glass ceilings. So it's about celebrating the achievements, but also acknowledging that there is a huge amount of work that we still have to do. But I think if you look back, as many of you will know, we're celebrating a decade of centenaries in Ireland at the moment. It's 100 years since the formation of this state. And even though we have a relatively young history, I think if you go as far back as the foundation of the state, and even before then, women have been fighting for equal rights from the very beginning, whether it's the right to vote, whether it's the right to own land, whether it's the right to sit on juries, whether it's the right to keep working when you're married, whether it's the right to work and have a family as well. This is something that has been fought for many, many years. And if you were to look at where we are now, it seems as though we have made huge progress, and it often feels as though we should be in a position where we have equality. If you look at on paper, we have robust anti-discrimination laws, we have institutions in place to help us vindicate our rights when we feel that we're being mistreated or we feel that we're being unfairly treated. But I think, as we can all appreciate, equality in law or equality on paper doesn't always equate to equality in practice. And that's why there's so much more that we need to do. And so I think this year's theme, Choose to Challenge, it's a very good theme. And I think really what we need to do is make sure that we choose ourselves to challenge the stereotypes that currently exist and to try and address many of the unequal stereotypes that still exist. And Lorraine spoke about the pandemic and how difficult this has been. And I do think it has impacted women in a different way than it has impacted men. I think women tend to take on more caring or more supporting roles within the home, where they're working at home, where they're minding children. And it's been extremely difficult. But even listening to Lorraine's examples and the experience of so many within the community, while this pandemic has been really difficult, and I think it has been such a challenge for so many people, it has brought out the best in so many people as well. And I think we need to harness so much of the positivity, so much of the good things that have happened within all of our communities, but in particular women, supporting and helping women, and make sure that when we start to come out of this pandemic, that we can bottle that and that we can feed into so much of the other work that needs to be done. At a government level, I suppose we have a number of things happening. We have the National Women and Girls Strategy, which has been implemented, and it's been implemented by my colleague, Minister O'Gorman. And this provides a clear roadmap as to how we can continue to progress in our society and to try and achieve equality. But I think if we're going to reflect the society that we live in, and that is one that I see as being modern, one that needs to be inclusive, we need to make sure that we have that type of diverse representation across all levels of our society. And that's from politics, that's from community leadership, that's looking at civil society. And the only way that we can actually do that is by actually putting ourselves forward. So the theme this year, Choose to Challenge, you know, I think we need to all challenge ourselves and think about what we do to improve lives for other women, women and girls. And the only way we can do that is by putting ourselves forward as well. The saying, I think, that you can't be what you can't see is particularly true, and particularly true for young girls. And it is community organisations such as yourselves, where you provide role models for young women and girls who aspire to be in the position that you're in, or in any other position in senior positionships. And we want them to aim high, and we want them to aim big. And one of the elements of my job that I love, while I'm a Minister for Justice, I'm also a TD, and I represent a constituency, and I spend a lot of time engaging with schools, engaging with students, albeit at the moment virtually, but I have an opportunity to link in and to talk to our young girls, and they are so ambitious and they are so driven, but at the same time, sometimes if they can't see something, they find it hard to know whether or not that's something that they can achieve themselves. So we want to, them to see themselves in positions of leadership. We want them to see themselves in elite sports and innovation and creativity. And if you look at our Taoiseach of Radcliffe, if you look at our Lord Mayor, Hazel Chu, if you look at one of our world ramp champion rowers, Sunita Persford, they've all come from migrant backgrounds. And I think it's, again, it's going back to you can't be what you can't see. So it's about putting ourselves out there, and it's about making sure that younger girls and women can see what they want to aspire to be as well. I am proud of our country, and I think Ireland has a diverse country. We have a multicultural and multi-faith society, and again, Minister O'Gorman, who is our Minister for Equality, speaks regularly, and I think we all agree with him on the importance of integration, and I completely agree. Our migrant integration strategy needs to have a whole of government approach. It's not just about one minister, it's not just about one group, it's about absolutely everybody embracing it, and making sure that we all play a role in promoting diversity and inclusion across all aspects of society. But also we have a role to play when it comes to preventing racism, when it comes to xenophobia, and when it comes to discrimination against women. And as Minister for Justice, this is something that I really am keen to address and keen to tackle. If we look at hate crimes, hate speech, they are there to disempower people, to disempower women, to silence their victims. And I think this came through very clearly in a public consultation that we held recently. And I know there are some women on the line and some people who contributed to that. And I just want to thank you sincerely, because it's only through understanding the lived experience of individuals that we can actually put in place the right policies and the right legislation to tackle these forms of discrimination, whether it's gender discrimination, whether it's based on religion, whether it's based on the community that you're from, the colour of your skin, your age, your disability or not. And as a result of this huge amount of engagement, I'll be bringing forward legislation, I hope in the Easter, so in the coming weeks, to try and combat the incitement to hatred and hate crimes that are happening across our country. What we want to make sure is that we have a society where people feel safe, where they feel protected, and this type of unacceptable behaviour from people who seek to spread hate and these type of fears simply cannot continue. And really, this is an example, I think, of how communities can work with government. And I've recently launched a strategy statement for the Department of Justice. And one of the really important elements of that strategy statement is continued engagement. It's engagement at all levels with all communities to make sure that every piece of work that we do, every piece of policy that we implement, every piece of legislation that is there to try and improve the lives of others, that it's based on real life experience, fact. And I think that's the only way that you get things right. You've asked me why I think the empowerment of women is important. And really, I think it's a very simple answer. When you empower women, you don't just empower one person. You empower their family, you empower communities, and it has this knock-on effect. And we can see that, you know, as I've said, women want to see other women in powerful positions, and by doing that, it has a multiplier effect, and it has a knock-on effect, not just within their community or their family, but the wider society as well. No one understands your community, your ambitions, your aspirations and hope for yourselves, for your children, or the difficulties that you may face better than you. And that's why each and every one of you stepping forward as well in the positions that you're in becoming leaders in your community, you are encouraging other women to do the same. So by empowering yourself, you're having such a knock-on effect and a multiplier effect on the people around you. And that then in itself has such an impact on the wider society and wider community. And so it's so important that we champion this, not just on International Women's Day, but every single day. We're still, as I said at the very beginning, we still have a long way to go, and seeing women in leadership positions and in senior decision-making roles, we're not quite where we need to be, but we are making progress. And I can see that even in the justice sector that I work in. I think I'm very, very lucky to be in the sector at a time where we have really wonderful women working at some of the top positions. I was delighted to welcome Una McPhillips, who is our Secretary General, the first female Secretary General in the Department of Justice. Only last year, we have our first CEO of the Court Service. We have new deputy commissioners, all of whom are women. We have women working within our Property Services Regulatory Authority, within the Chief State Pathologist's Office. And all of these are really positive. But what I look forward to most is a day where we don't have to celebrate firsts, where we don't have to celebrate how wonderful it is to have women in these type of senior positions, and that it's just the norm. But I'll be speaking to many of them later this afternoon and on a particular roundtable event, and obviously would be wonderful if any of you could join that as well. The same must be true for our migrant communities, and we should expect that every single person in Ireland living here, working here, raising a family here, that everybody has the same opportunities to thrive, to reach their full potential, to reach these positions, and to encourage other women to do the same. And so today, again, I suppose I would challenge us all to think about what can we do in the next week, in the next month, in the next year to make life better and to improve life for the women and girls around us. And I think that's something we all need to think about, and we all need to maybe decide what are we going to do to make life better for those around us, because by doing that, there really is a multiplier effect. But I just want to thank you for inviting me to speak with you today. It's been a real pleasure, and just to encourage you to continue to encourage young women and girls from migrant communities to follow in your footsteps, to become leaders, as so many of you are. And by doing this, you really are empowering the next generation. So thank you very much for your time. And hopefully I'll be able to meet you in person in the next few months as things ease up. But for today, it's wonderful to be able to join you on Zoom.
Thank you so much, Minister Helen McEntee. It was a pleasure having you over. That was a very encouraging and inspiring talk, and I can see people virtually clapping there for you. So that was your applause. It was really, like, there were a lot of points that I really loved, especially like your work on the hate crime legislation and how it is important to choose to challenge in order to break stereotypes. And also, when you empower a woman, when you empower a young girl, you empower the family, the community, and the wider society as well. So really, it was a pleasure to have you this morning, and we hope you can continue to be with us until whenever you are able to. And before I introduce our next speaker for this morning, I'd just like to remind you, if anyone of you are on Twitter or members of the press, we are using #IWD2021 and #ChooseToChallenge. Our next speaker is the lovely Yara Alaga. It has been a personal pleasure knowing Yara over the years through community work. Yara is originally Palestinian. She completed her master's in public affairs and political communications from TUD in 2020. As part of her master's, she did research around the Muslim community's engagement in politics in Ireland. She is now working as a parliamentary assistant to the Civil Engagement Group, which is made up of four independent female senators, including Senator Eileen Flynn. She works on different policy areas like education, Brexit, children, disability, equality, and integration. She also volunteers with different organizations like Amal Association that works on improving conditions for migrants in Ireland. Yara will be speaking to us on love, belief, and acceptance. Welcome, Yara.
Hi all. First of all, thank you so much for inviting me, and I think you've made it really difficult for me by slotting me in after Minister McEntee, but I'm really, really honoured to be sharing a panel with some amazing, you know, trailblazers, including Minister McEntee and my colleague Eileen Flynn. So thanks so much. And I suppose when I was thinking about what to say for this, or, you know, what to speak to, and I was telling Lorraine this earlier, you know, there's a lot of pressure in society, in certain spaces, particularly the political space, to feel like you have to choose, I suppose, whether you're going to assimilate or be fully excluded from society, like this binary of, you know, are you in or are you out? And particularly if you're from a minority background, otherwise sometimes you're made to feel like there's no space for you, that you won't fit in, that what you have to say won't be important. But I think for me, and something that, you know, Muslim Sisters of Eire really have instilled and have really inspired me with, is having pride in oneself, embracing your diverse skills and your experience, and seeing what, you know, our collective strengths are as a community, and how we can use these strengths to bring about change. And, you know, Muslim Sisters of Eire have you know, have really shown that, and you know, this inclusivity of diverse backgrounds and communities and all our spaces will inevitably enrich the outcome and results. And I'm really reminded of the Quranic verse from Surah Al-Hujurat where God tells us, you know, and we made you into nations and tribes that you may get to know each other. So we, you know, I really believe, you know, we are created to cooperate with each other, to collectively help mankind. And I suppose what I kind of want to speak to is, you know, using this diversity and using our differences and as strengths and use it to differentiate yourself from others. I really believe if you come from a minority background or if you have a diverse background, to really use that to your advantage. And first and foremost, build pride within yourself. I think faith is perceived as something that's strange and outdated, especially, you know, for the youth. But we should build enough, you know, confidence in ourselves as Muslims that our faith can never be compromised. And I think, you know, I'm delving into, you know, the political landscape, and I've studied political communications and I'm working in a political Irish structure. But I really think that I have, you know, from this, I've come to the conclusion that I suppose studying politics and working within a political landscape and having lived your life as being politicized are two very different things and different learning experiences. So what I was studying in college, which was really interesting, was just really different from the reality that I've experienced personally as a Muslim, a female, as a minority, and the way in which Muslims, particularly Muslim women, have been politicized, whether that be true, you know, our hijabs, our burqas, our clothing clothing attire, shows that we have a long way to go in terms of achieving true equality. And that's why a lot of what I do and believe in is deeply rooted in my background and my roots as a, you know, as a Muslim female born and raised in Ireland. And I think the challenges and struggles of being visibly Muslim is inevitable in a political climate that we're in today. I'm sure, you know, I'm not sure you'll ever meet a Muslim female who hasn't faced some sort of harassment, whether that be, you know, verbal, physical abuse. And I don't want to highlight those challenges because the theme today is really beautiful and is really focusing on love and compassion and positivity. But I also think, you know, we are more than likely as a female, you know, as females wearing hijabs, you're going to be in a situation where you're the only one. But I really believe people will receive that really well. And I think for Muslims, for us Muslim females, or for any member of an ethnic minority group, it should be a source of motivation for us to seek real change. But I also want to, I suppose, when we look back retrospectively, I think this year has brought an unexpected amount of unity that I think we hadn't seen before. And particularly, I suppose, I've noticed within my immediate inner circle and wider circle is the growing desire to remove the stigma around mental health. I think people are more open about their feelings and how difficult this pandemic and the situation has been for many of us. We've really begun to unshroud our feelings without feeling like we're the only one, because there's not a single person who hasn't been directly or indirectly impacted by the pandemic. So I really believe, you know, this year, despite the hardships, the adversities, the challenges, it has brought a lot of compassion, a lot of interconnectedness that I hadn't seen before. And I think if there's one thing we can learn from and leave behind in this pandemic, it's that we should abolish the stigma around mental health. And I think I'm seeing it within, like I said, my immediate circle. People are more willing to open up, and you know, when I speak to people, the response is often, you know, I've had a rough few days, or, you know, today was actually a good day for once. Or so I think it's having a positive impact on how we perceive mental health and how we hopefully can develop now, finally, develop and create the necessary services and structures to begin to tackle these issues. So I think that's something I've noticed when I look back on this year as being something that's important and positive, and I think it'll have a really important long-term impact. So that's just kind of some of my, I suppose, observations and what I wanted to kind of focus on. So
thank you so much, Yara. That was a lovely, lovely talk, and really touched, especially when you speak about inclusivity and diversity. I'm not sure if many of you may not know, but our team is so diverse. It is like the United Colors of Benetton. So we've people from all over. We have people from Ireland, people from England, people from Australia, India, Pakistan, Malaysia, Nigeria, South Africa. Lorraine, what am I missing? What country am I missing?
Mauritius, Nora.
Mauritius, Scotland.
Yeah. Scotland. We did South Africa. Oh, look, Muslim Sisters of Eire is in every corners of the world, alhamdulillah, thank God.
So, and on a Friday night, on a typical Friday night, if you look at the cuisines on the table, Eastern Europe, you're right, Jasmina.
We have Latvia, Bosnia, Yugoslavia, we have,
So the food that is served out there is so diverse, like it's like an international buffet. So we're very blessed to have so much diversity. Thank you, Yara. Continuing to our team of empowering women through politics, I'd like to welcome our next speaker this morning. Eileen Flynn is an Irish independent politician who has served as a senator since June 2020, after being nominated by the Taoiseach. Her background is in community development and activism on behalf of Irish travellers. In June 2020, Taoiseach Michael Martin appointed Senator Flynn to the Irish Senate. She is the first traveller to serve in the Oireachtas. Eileen's topic today is empowering women through politics. Welcome, Eileen. We're very glad you could join us today.
Thank you so much. And I would like to thank the Muslim Sisters of Eire for all of their hard work over the many months and even last year and within the last year, their hard work they're doing with the homeless people and the streets of Ireland. So just to say that. Today, as we mark International Women's Day, we have to remember that International Women's Day and celebrating women is for all women. It's not just for one group of women or for one colour of skin of women. And here in Ireland, really, the majority of women, like our Dáil is made up of 22% of women. Our Seanad is made up by just over 40% of women. And a lot of the Taoiseach's nominees were women. And even now with the by-election, there seems to be an awful lot of men going for the by-election. So for me, as a traveller woman, this time last year, I set out on a journey to make history and get in the seat. I didn't only see myself as a traveller woman, I see myself as a woman from an ethnic minority group, a woman who's seen as another in Irish society. So that gave me the power to go for the seat. But throughout my years of being an activist and being a traveller woman, since I was very young, at the age of 17, I first met a Muslim woman who didn't wear a hijab. But I remember getting stopped on the way back from Italy, and she was getting searched by like three sets of security. So she stopped at one security, got searched the same as another and another. And I couldn't get my head around it. So I said to her, Amel, why is all this happening to you? And she said, well, Eileen, I'm a Muslim woman, and this is what happens to Muslim women during when we go to airports. And that opened up my mind, and I wanted to get to know Muslim women better. Now, again, like the fear of the unknown, not really knowing what Muslim religion meant, and some of that, my own prejudices as well that came with that, you know. So I mixed along with Muslim women. I then in 2014 heard a story from a Muslim woman where she was spat at an O'Connell brooch because of her hijab. And ever since then, my passion for hate crime legislation has, like, and this kind of motivated me to get this seat as well, because there needs to be a good hate crime legislation in Ireland. And I'm proud to say on Wednesday, the 10th of March, I'm launching the hate crime with Ina, the Love Not Hate campaign again. It's the second time for this campaign to be published, and I hope Minister McEntee, as the only woman who ever stood as Minister for Justice, will pass good hate crime legislation for ethnic minority groups like us, you know. And I think that will empower women to be able to walk the streets of Dublin wearing their hijabs and not being afraid because they have a hijab, or not being afraid of their religion or the background they come from, that they're going to be spat at or told to get off the bus, or anything else that goes with it, any kind of a hate crime that goes with it, and even racism and discrimination that Muslim women face on a daily basis, like traveller women, is not acceptable today in the day's world. And I know in the last year we've seen that sense of unity, and especially Minister, since you've came into the House and since you've took on the role of Minister for Justice, you know, I think our Dáil has been speaking a lot lately around an ending direct provision and speaking a lot around diversity. So that is a positive step in the right direction. But for me, you know, I would love to see an Oireachtas, a Dáil, a Seanad, where it's not all white women who have lovely, like you can see their hair, and like, you know, I want to see an Oireachtas where we see diversity within our Oireachtas, where we're able to see women proudly wearing hijabs, able to see women proudly being themselves and still around the political table, because politics has an impact on all of us, no matter our class or our background. And right now in Ireland, politics is really impacting on Muslim women and people living in direct provision. So who knows, possibly in the next Dáil, we'll have a woman from the Muslim community in the House of the Oireachtas. That would be a day of change for me. That would be a day of empowering, as the minister rightly said, and I know from my own experience, if young women can't see it, they can't be it. Me, myself, I felt my whole life I was never going to be anything else, only a traveller woman, you know, because even within my own family circle, my family would say to me, Jesus, Eileen, all this old voluntary work, you'll never be idle, you know, you'll always be doing something. And they had a point in a sense, and it was always that, so you're never going to be anything, you're only a traveller. And I imagine it's the same way for Muslim women, thinking, you know, I'm never going to be anything except a Muslim woman. And I don't think that should be the case for any woman, you know. I think even for young travellers now in Ireland, a young traveller women, to see a woman in the House of the Oireachtas, you know, would empower them to go on into politics if they wish to win the politics. And like I speak an awful lot around diversity, and I speak an awful lot around women from ethnic minority groups, and passionately speak around Muslim women, but I'm not a Muslim woman, you know. I don't know what it's like to be a Muslim woman, except from sitting around with the male women, from sitting and speaking, doing work with migrant women from the likes of Mauritius. I didn't even know Mauritius was a country until 2015, and getting to know women from different backgrounds. But also while you're bringing stuff to the front in their Oireachtas, you know, you always have to be mindful that I'm not a Muslim woman, and I always believe that there's nothing about us without us, and I think, you know, that we should be inclusive of all women in politics, all women. When we talk about International Women's Day, it needs to be an inclusive all an International Women's Day. It needs to include Muslim women, traveller women, disabled women, women from all different walks of life, because it can't just be equality and voices for one set of women and not for not for all women. So I'm working very closely now with Yara. And when Yara approached me to do the day's event, and Lorraine gave me an email, it was ever such a panic, you know, and I was just delighted to accept the request to be here today and to listen to other women's stories. But what really highlights for me today is Minister McEntee talking about the hate crime legislation and how we're looking at Easter, which is literally only down the road. So that there is a positive change for all people in from ethnic minority groups. And, you know, Yara spoke very passionate around accepting yourself. And I think sometimes, like when I was 25 years of age, I was always ashamed of being a traveller woman, you know. I was always, from 18 to 25, there was that sense of being ashamed, like I'm only a traveller, people see me as dirt in the world, blah, blah, blah. And I came to accept that, you know, it wasn't that I wasn't good enough for society. It was society wasn't good enough for us as a community of people. And it's the same way for people who are Muslim as well in Ireland, and especially for women who don't hide and can't hide your identity. You know, if you have a hijab, you're automatically known as a Muslim person. So I think for some of us, while we grew up our life hiding our identity, that can have an impact on our mental health and our well-being, as Yara rightly pointed out. And, you know, it's not just women like us. We don't need to be saved. You know, we don't need to be saved by white upper class women. What we need as ethnic minority groups is a hand up. You know, we don't need handouts, we need a hand up, and that hand up will empower other women from within our communities. And for me, working so closely with a young woman like Yara for the last few months, trust me when I say I wouldn't be able to do half of the committee meetings without having Yara. And our biggest focus as two women from two ethnic minority groups is women in the marriage of society. And just to say, you know, today I'd like to think about my own mother, who empowered me growing up as a child, and she's over 20 years dead. And she always had a quote saying, nobody knows the shoes cutting the money, the person that's wearing them. And I think while Ireland seems to be a more equal Ireland, but we have to ask ourselves the question, who's the more equal Ireland for? You know, is it Ireland's own equal Ireland, or is it for us all, you know, because who lives in Ireland belongs in Ireland. And I think that's a very powerful quote for today, is who lives here belongs here. And just to say that, you know, for Minister McEntee also pointed out around the 100 years of, you know, women in power, women being able to vote, women in parliament. It took 99 years to get a woman from an ethnic minority group to be, and when I say an ethnic minority group, I mean a traveller woman, because I know Catherine Despone was a woman from an ethnic minority group as well. But 100 years after, you know, and now we don't have to wait another 100 years to get in a Muslim woman or a Black woman or a woman from other ethnic minority groups into the House of Directors. I just want to say that. And again, a very happy International Women's Day to you all. And I look forward to working with you all in the future and to keep up the great work that the Muslim Sisters of Eire is doing. So thank you all very, very much.
Thank you so much, Senator Eileen Flynn. That was really, really empowering, and lots of food for thought there. Like the question about who is the equality for, or I think we could all relate. And I could see heads nodding when you narrated the incident about being stopped at the airport. We've all been stopped, haven't we? So, thank you, Eileen. Really enjoyed listening to your speech. Very motivating and empowering, especially for the youth listening in today. Mm. And speaking of the youth, our next speaker is our youth volunteer who has been volunteering with Muslim Sisters of Eire since she was very young. I suppose from your primary days. Hafsa Sayed is 17 years old and she's a fifth year student. Today, she will take us through a different viewpoint, the pandemic to the eyes of a young Muslim girl. Over to you, Hafsa.
Zakallah. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Right, so I'm just going to start off with a quote that really helped me create this speech. So, life comes with many challenges. The ones that should not scare us are the ones we can take on and take control of. No doubt, we are all living in a very challenging time. The Muslim youth is no exception. Tackling mental health, school, and a social life today is a struggle. It is a journey majority of you have taken, one we are all taking. It is clear that the pandemic has altered our view and approach to each of these topics of discussion. Mental health in particular. It has changed how we deal with the problem, our perspective and attitude. The lack of attention given by our society has contributed a large part to the widespread mental health problems that have been plaguing us for a very long time, which now have been worsened by COVID-19. My aim is to voice my perspective of how I personally, with the help of others, dealt with this. No doubt, COVID-19 has released a wide range of very difficult emotions. People are struggling with tremendous anxiety, uncertainty, fear, sadness, loneliness, and depression. But how do we deal with this skillfully? Everyone's situation is different. How I would deal with something is not necessarily the same way my sister would. So, however, something that helped my family get through this endless string of negativity that surrounds us was establishing a process called reframing. It is a process of deliberately thinking different about our situation, reframing it. The fact is, the lens through which we see our circumstances makes all the difference in the world insofar as how we feel. Thoughts are like front wheels of a car, and feelings are like the back wheels. We must be in control of the car, steering intentionally. Whichever way the wheels turn, the back wheels will follow. So paying attention to our thoughts, moment by moment, and making sure that they are aligned with the Quran and Sunnah is crucial. The mind is like a muscle that must be trained through specific exercises, and our tradition is rich in techniques for doing so. The technique really helped me deal with the gloomy atmosphere of lockdown and isolation. A small example would be when feeling anxious, I would mentally review what I'd been thinking about what had raised the difficult emotion. Then do a quick search and replace, deliberately and intentionally replacing your dark thought with the light of the Quran and Sunnah. Here's one example. I'll never get through this, and replace it with, Allah never burdens a person with more than he is well able to bear. This verse is found in the Quran. The process really helped me and my family get through the first lockdown together. Sitting on the dinner table and voicing our anxiety and uncertainty in regards to what is happening really helped us all, regardless of age. Looking back, I'm really grateful for my family, a group of people I'm embarrassed to say that I had previously taken for granted. Having spent so long with them, I've come to terms with the fact that they will always be there, no matter what. I got to know them better, whether they like it or not. It's definitely one of the positives of lockdown. Like I said before, deliberately think differently about the situation. However, my family is not the only way I dealt with the glooms of lockdown. Engaging with MSOE and contributing to their various campaigns is another way I took my mind off of things. I've been volunteering since MSOE since I was 12. Volunteering. This verb has really redefined itself. Personally, it no longer means standing in front of the GPO and serving the homeless on a Friday night, or handing out goodie bags to refugee kids on the eat day. It now means baking sweets for hardworking frontline workers and helping my mom cook for unfortunate families struck with the virus. Despite having altered my perspective on what is perceived as volunteering, I can still feel the joy of helping others without having been there myself. I can still feel thankful. In fact, in this time, it has made me more thankful than before. It made me feel grateful that I'm safe in my home with my family, all of the things I took for granted. Amongst the few aspects of my life pre-COVID that I failed to appreciate was in my education and friends. School is something I definitely took for granted, something my sisters in many countries are still fighting for. When we were told that school was going to be closed, I remember being delighted. Little did I know that I would miss it, that I would not be able to see my friends every day at lunch, that I was going to have to stare at my screen for the whole day, only to not remember what I had learned only a couple of hours later. It goes without saying that there is and was a lack of motivation to study in general. It is hard to stay strong and driven for something that we cannot imagine happening in the near future. We have the same mindset relating to COVID. How can we stay strong without seeing the end in sight? Personally, I see it as we are on a very long hike up a very steep mountain, and we only have two choices about how we approach this challenge, unskillfully or skillfully. If we wear flip-flops and fail to pack water and snacks, we will have a very difficult time reaching the summit. And if we do so, we will be in very bad shape. If we wear good socks, sturdy hiking boots, and our backpack is well stocked, not only are we likely to reach the summit, but in great shape. Now the question is, how do we get in that great shape? We could start by being grateful for what we have now without having to realize it when it is gone. Surrounding ourselves with hobbies that bring us joy and gratefulness adds to us building that great shape. Lastly, we can reframe and modify our perspective towards this present day normality that we are approaching. Like I stated before, life comes with many challenges. The ones that should not scare us are the ones we can take on and take control of. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Hafsa. Well done. We have personally witnessed that the young generation, the youth, have been so resilient through this pandemic year and stepping up where they were needed, and absolutely fantastic experience there that you shared with us. Thank you so much, Hafsa. Our next speaker this wonderful International Women's Day is Minister Roderic O’Gorman. Roderic O’Gorman TD is the Minister for Children, Equality, Disability, Integration and Youth. He was appointed to this role in June 2020. Roderic was elected to represent the Dublin West constituency in the 2020 general election. Prior to being elected to Dáil Éireann, he served on the Fingal County Council, having been first elected in 2014 and re-elected in 2019, representing the Green Party. He has also served on the Board of Management of 5 schools. The Minister will be speaking of his experience with migrant women integrating in Ireland and his International Women's Day's message to women, especially migrant women.
Thanks so much, Aisha. Can you hear me all right there?
Yep, we can hear you.
You can hear me okay. Brilliant. Thank you very much. Look, I'm absolutely delighted to be here today. I want to thank Muslim Sisters of Eire for the invitation to attend your event today and to celebrate International Women's Day with you, and also to recognise the social, economic, cultural and political achievements of women across Ireland, particularly those coming from migrant and minority communities. And your event today features a really impressive array of speakers, and as such, it's a real honour to have been invited to address you as one of them. And with so many International Women's Day events going on, I'm really excited to be invited to speak at this one. I'm here today to speak a bit about the work being done by government in supporting integration, particularly amongst migrant women. But if you'll allow me, I suppose, I wouldn't mind being able to speak to the wider theme of today's event, which is love in a time of pandemic. So maybe just to begin, just to make it clear that as a government, we are committed to supporting women from migrant and minority backgrounds and supporting integration. And as Minister for Integration, I chair the National Migrant Integration Strategy, which aims to provide opportunities for the equal participation of all migrants across society and seeks to protect those who are most vulnerable in the context of migration, such as migrant women, children, victims of domestic or gender-based violence. And through the National Integration Fund and the Communities Integration Fund, my department supports a number of initiatives to empower migrant women, both on the national level and through local community-based projects. And I know your own organisation has benefited from funding from the Communities Integration Fund in the last number of years. You're probably aware that 2 weeks ago, we launched a white paper which sets out how the government will end direct provision and move to a new system of accommodation and support for people in the international protection system, people who are seeking asylum here in this country. And the core of that policy is integration from day one. We will end the institutionalization and the isolation that has so often accompanied direct provision as it currently operates. And within this, we're also committed to specifically supporting women, be it through healthcare, through childcare, and through the provision of specialist supports for victims of domestic, sexual, or gender-based violence. Our national strategy for women and girls also seeks to ensure a gender perspective is integrated into decision-making in a wide range of policies. And a Citizens' Assembly on gender equality is currently taking place to make policy proposals to advance gender equality in Ireland. So these are just some aspects of wider commitments to improve integration and to improve equality. And gender inequality, it intersects with and it compounds existing inequalities that migrant women face within our communities, and it inhibits migrants' ability to engage with existing supports. And I think the COVID-19 pandemic, and it's been spoken about by the last speaker, has exposed and exacerbated many existing inequalities in society, including the inequality that disadvantages women. And in the context of the pandemic, women have played an absolutely crucial role in the response. And figures coming from EU bodies like the European Institute for Gender Equality, those figures indicate that a majority of the workers who've been delivering essential services in the EU responding to the crisis are actually women. So 76% of the doctors, nurses, midwives and staff in residential care homes are women. 82% of cashiers, 93% of childcare workers and teachers, 95% of domestic cleaners and helpers, and 86% of personal care workers, all women, all working on the front line in responding to this crisis. And we know too that many of these sectors have a very high proportion of people from migrant backgrounds working with them as well. I really want to pay tribute to these women, particularly from migrant or minority backgrounds, who have gone out to work every day for the past year And that's often been a great hardship to their own families. But that work, that commitment has allowed us as a country maintain the restrictions that are needed to keep everybody in Ireland safe. And for those from a migrant background, sometimes very far away from their family, the isolation that I think we've all experienced in the last 12 months must have been even more acute. Many of you will now be facing over a year without seeing your families, with grandparents abroad, watching over Zoom as their children grow up. And the pain of that must be really profound. And it is in that context that having friends and having community support becomes so important. And it's that that makes the work of Muslim Sisters of Eire even more essential. Civil society and women's organisations have played a leading role in the management of Ireland's response to the pandemic. And this work has included highlighting where existing inequalities have been exacerbated and where marginalised groups of women have become even more vulnerable during the pandemic. I was reflecting on the theme of today's conference, Love in the Time of Pandemic. And I suppose as a politician, I often speak in the language of policy, that kind of cold language of implementation, analysis, legislation. And look, for a progressive party like the Green Party, we do talk about transformation, creating substantial change. But to talk about love in politics is a radical act. Compassion, true compassion, compassion when it's not obvious and easiest, is often the hardest thing to do. And the academic bell hooks wrote that the moment we choose love, we begin to move against domination, against oppression. The moment we choose love, we begin to march, we begin to move towards freedom, to act in ways that liberate ourselves and others. That action is the testimony of love as the practice of freedom. I just thought that was a really apposite quotation. And migrants, particularly migrant women, have always faced oppression, and an oppression that is very often acute. They are often written from history. Their role in holding up the edifice of so many nations is removed from the pages of our history books. And we see that these active attempts at oppression continue online today. We're all very aware of it. And we see it in the racism, the misogyny, and the threats that so many women face, particularly migrant women and women of color. And despite this intimidation, we also see migrant women standing up and asserting their rights and supporting each other. And, you know, as minister, because of COVID, I've been able to make very few visits around the country to various organisations or various groups. But in August, during the brief loosening of restrictions then, I got to visit Hill Street Family Resource Centre in North inner city Dublin. And a core part of what Hill Street does is supporting migrant women in integrating into the local community. They support women in so many practical ways, support that makes a huge difference in the lives of those they help. They offer peer support, and in doing so, they lift each other up. And again, I saw that very much as people choosing the act of love as a means of liberating others. Prior to today's events, I was reading and familiarising myself with some of the activities and some of the work that Muslim Sisters of Eire undertake, and promoting an understanding of Islam, working to promote social integration, diversity and empowerment of women. And I know particularly you're engaged in a very interesting and innovative homelessness support programme. And I have seen your organisation out on the streets at night providing meals. I know you've also worked with organisations like Merchants Quay Ireland, helping to give assistance, helping to give support to some of the most marginalised and the most vulnerable people in Ireland. I'm from the Dublin 15 area, and we have a local group called Muslim Women Together. And that group has a long history of social outreach. And the annual highlight of that is its yearly food fest, which is also always a massively attended event every year, which sees really significant sums of money being collected for charitable organisations. So volunteer networks like these have played an absolutely crucial role in the management of Ireland's response to the pandemic. And you have offered a lifeline to these vulnerable communities through your outreach work. And it is these acts of outreach, these acts of kindness, it's in these that we see the power of love in a time of pandemic. It's the kindness that we see, that where we see love as a radical act. So I'd just like to finish today by commending you for the work you're doing. supporting our most vulnerable, supporting migrant women, and taking that radical action within our communities. And for my own part, I'm determined that government will continue to support integration and continue to support those who are helping on our front lines. So again, happy International Women's Day to you all. Thank you so much for the invitation to speak at this fantastic event. And I look forward to continuing to support and work with your organisation.
Thank you so much, Minister Roderic O’Gorman. It was a really, really, really enjoyed listening to your experiences, especially when you said volunteer networks have such an important role to play during the time of pandemic. And I suppose, Lorraine, we can relate there how we've seen such a massive increase. Would you like to?
The increase during the pandemic, the increase of the need for services like ourselves, the need within the homeless sector, I suppose, the feeding every week. As I said earlier, before you come on, pre-pandemic, we fed 250 a week. We're up to 570 a week now. If you multiply that by four, it's over 2,000 people a week looking to be fed. Also, I suppose the aspect of support network, the Muslim Sisters of Eire have a hotline every Monday. The women are trained in rape crisis, domestic violence, also Gashka leaders. We have our youth on as well with us doing Gashka. And the women are highly skilled and very trained women, and they're out there in all different aspects and meeting the needs of migrant women constantly, whether it be down at the homeless, whether it be a hotline, domestic violence is very much there. It's widespread, whatever minority you belong in. So, the work of Muslim Sisters of Eire is very much there. And I like the points that you did touch on. And I suppose we need to look forward, or instead of International Women's Day, is maybe set up some kind of a Zoom meeting and see how we can work on future with the organisation together with not also Helen McEntee, the Minister of Justice, but yourself, Roderick, and Ellen, and see how we can move forward as an organisation that does so much work out there. And as I said, I always say there's Muslim Sisters of Eire, and we're going that way. We're going every way, meeting so many different needs that sometimes we're nearly on burnout. But such an inspiring talk, and we look forward to working with you in the future.
Thank you, Lorraine. Okay, so we are nearly towards the end of the day, not quite there yet. So at this stage, we'd like to open the floor for anybody who would like to share something they liked from the conference. If you have any questions or any comments, you can send it through in the chat box or raise your hand or unmute yourself one by one. Something's come up in the chat box. Elaine says, thank you so much for organizing this inspiring meeting. Such interesting speakers. I'm a huge fan of all of your outreach work in the community. Happy International Women's Day to you. Thank you, Elaine.
She's on mute, Aisha. I suppose I'd like to just talk there to Eileen Flynn. I think you do amazing work. I think you're a great spokesperson for ethnic minority groups. I totally behind you, totally support you. Again, Muslim Sisters of Eire would like to sit down, kind of maybe pop into the office and have a meeting and see how we can work forward. And the hate crime bill is very much needed. Being an Irish woman, originally from Coolock, the north side of Dublin, I've been very much victimised in racial discrimination because of the hijab. You're initially seen to be a foreigner, you know what I mean, until your mouth opens and then they realize you're not a foreigner. But how we could work on something like that would be definitely, I know we do have, we did have a poll going, signatures. And I know we've over 5,000 signatures at the moment, and we will, in the near future, submit that. And maybe we'd go through yourself, hand over the signatures to yourself, because I think the work that you're doing is really, really empowering.
On Wednesday, Lorraine, and it's like that, Lorraine, it's the work of the Muslim Sisters of Eire as well is very empowering for me, you know, that kind of way, and to see the great work that the women are doing. And, you know, sometimes it's like you know the way we say look after our own and the rise of the far right and stuff. And sometimes for people to see that, it's very empowering that like we do have people from ethnic minority groups and the streets helping all of our homeless, you know. So I would like to say that today as well. And any support I can give, and I am very mindful just to say to the Muslim women around this table, because it used to kill me and put diggers through my heart when people would talk in behalf of travellers when they weren't members of the traveller community. And there, I tend not to talk for Muslim women because I don't think it's right. Muslim women can speak for themselves. But now with the platform that I have, I use it to the advantage of bringing in Muslim women, you know. And I work very closely. Again, I'm not ashamed to say that I'd be lost without Yara in the group. And myself and Yara are working on hate crime legislation. But we're looking for a hate crime legislation that will work for everybody, you know. And it's such a solidarity. And Yara is very passionate about it, and so am I. So we're forming a little group of like 6-7 people. Yara is going to be part of that group to implement a good hate crime legislation. Now, it's great to hear the minister talk about legislation and stuff, but it's not about it being a talk shop. And this Wednesday, the 10th, we're launching the Love Na Hate campaign. So it'll be brilliant to get those signatures and to add it into that campaign, Lorraine. And thanks so much to you.
Yeah, as Lorraine said, like this petition was launched a couple of years ago, I suppose a year and a half or 2 years ago, and we have all of them signatures, so we will pass them on to you. Thank you so much, everyone. I can see that our last guest is here now, so I would like to welcome her, our very special guest, Mary Lou McDonald. Mary Lou McDonald is the leader of Sinn Féin and Tíocht Ó Dála for Dublin's cultural constituency. She's proud to represent the people of Dublin Central, where she has a reputation for hard work and championing the needs for her constituency, both locally and nationally. She was an MEEP for Dublin from 2004 to 2009, and during her time in the European Parliament, Mary Lou was a prominent member of the Employment and Social Affairs Committee and Civil Liberties Committee. On this International Women's Day, we'd like to welcome her as our final speaker for this morning. Welcome, Mary Lou.
Thank you so much, and I'm absolutely delighted to be here with you. I had some technological issues at this end, so I'm sorry that I was arriving a small bit late. But listen, firstly, a very, very happy International Women's Day to each and every one of you. It is a day on which we reflect on many things. This year, we're reflecting, I think, so appropriately on love. And we do so in extraordinary times where the world has been turned upside down and people have been asked to do things that a year or 2 years ago would have seemed frankly unimaginable. And we've seen at first hand the real pain and suffering that has come in the course of the last year, but we've seen also the deep wells of resilience within our community and in our women, I think in particular, women in community, women in leadership, women with our struggles, which are common to all of us, cut across creed, colour, class, sexual orientation. And they are the things that really bind us in common cause. So I suppose this afternoon I wanted to say just a couple of things for my part. Firstly, to say this, that every individual, every organization, every activist that works for inclusion and for social justice works to bring us all to the light. And the issues of social solidarity in these times are particularly acute, but we need to be honest and say that many of the big challenges that we face now, and I just got the end of Eileen's remarks so eloquently put there, many of the challenges that we face now are challenges that were with us long before we ever heard of COVID-19, long before this virus invaded our lives in the way that it did. And so we have an opportunity now in a time of trauma and challenge to create for ourselves an opportunity to start anew, to bring things back to the fundamentals and to ask ourselves the most profound and yet simple questions. And core to that is, what kind of a society do we wish to create? And I believe, and I think we all believe, we want a society that is based in the first instance on the solid foundations of equality. Equality for every citizen, equality of opportunity, equality in the eyes of the law, but also a society which is welcoming and which celebrates diversity rather than creating divisions and building walls. A society that brings people together and understands that diversity is strength. And I am very aware that for many women, for migrant women, for women of colour, for women from different ethnic and religious backgrounds, different cultural backgrounds, that Ireland can, the Ireland of 2021 can be a challenging place, can be a cold place for some. And we have to be honest about that too. And more importantly, we have to resolve that we will tackle it, that we will sort it out, that we will face all of these challenges together. So issues of hate crime, hate speech, discriminatory behavior, wherever it happens, needs to be challenged, and we need stronger law to protect people. That is very, very true. And we also need a system and a politics that recognizes that not alone do people face those discriminations, but also the awful, unbearable reality of poverty, of being economically excluded also. And I think we need to tackle both of those things, because real societal change involves, yes, changes in law, changes in attitudes, changes in behavior, a change of heart in how we regard each other as human beings. But we also need an economic change. And we know for a long time, since time immemorial, that women will always bear the hardest, roughest edges of poverty, of need. And that has been the case in Ireland, just as it is reflected internationally. So in reflecting on building a society around love and inclusion and equality and rejecting hate and division and exclusion, I think we need to hardwire in all of those factors and recognize also that in building this society, that women are not a homogenous group. Women have different experiences, different expectations. And that's true, of course, for men also. It's true of human society. But we have to agree on the fundamentals. We have to agree on the fundamental core values that bind us all. As you know, I'm an Irish Republican. I'm the leader of Sinn Féin. We're a party that has argued and that has worked for and will continue to work for a new Ireland, a united Ireland in our lifetimes, for very profound political and constitutional change. And that process of change isn't simply a geographic thing. We are talking about a profound change that challenges and transforms Ireland at its core, from a country that has a past history of colonialism, of being colonized, of division, of emigration, of dispossession, into a country of mass emigration, let it be said, into one that is built on inclusion, into a society that is increasingly more diverse and that celebrates that diversity, that welcomes it, and that builds the new Ireland that can be constructed on that basis. So I think there's great cause for optimism and hope, even though I don't for a second underestimate the challenges that face every single one of us. But if history teaches us one thing here on this island, but also right across the globe for generations, it is this, that women can and do drive change and social equality and inclusion. And even when the odds seem very high, there is no doubt that working together in solidarity, we can move mountains. We can change Ireland. As a matter of fact, we can change the world. I believe that. That's why I'm in political life. So I want to thank you very much for inviting me and for allowing me these few moments to make a contribution to your meeting. And I wish you happiness. I wish you success. And above all else, I wish you love on this International Women's Day, our day.
Thank you so much, Mary Lou. We were absolutely delighted to have you over, and the points that you said were excellent, like diversity is strength, and together we can all get through this. And celebrating diversity is the way forward for New Ireland. I think, Lorraine, would you like to share how excited we were to have her on board?
Yeah. Hey, Mary Lou. You were a hard fish to catch, but we caught you, thank God. You know where a woman keeps going? There was no answer. I said, scroll down that email. There has to be a phone number. Let me talk.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're really privileged to have you today. You're a very strong woman. And I suppose the reason why I wanted you on today was, you know, you're an icon for women. To say, you know, I always say the world is your oyster. Keep going for what you believe in. And that is the main thing. Never let anything pull you down. As long as you believe, keep going. And you're that prime example. So that is so much why I wanted to have you this morning for the team here and for the outer community of migrant women here, you know, and for the, you know, non-migrant women, the Irish women who are joining us here this morning as well. And it's just to keep them going and to say, you know, you look at how far you've come. And I loved what you were ending on there. You believe we can change the world. Well, I believe that too. As long as you have that belief inside you, I always say that the world is your oyster. Keep going. Don't let anything bring you down. And people will bring you down. They will bring you down. But you just get up and you keep going. So, yeah, thank you so much. I really, really am grateful for you to take time out of your busy schedule. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Lorraine.
You're welcome.
Lorraine, would you like to play the video before we move forward? Okay, you're on mute, so we can't hear you.
Let me give her a kiss goodbye. Let me hear. Basically, this is a video of the work that we have done. We showed it last year on our 10th anniversary. But this video, you can just, you know, I'm not going to say anything. You can just see by yourself of the amazing achievements these women have achieved. So with no further ado, if you go ahead, it'd be lovely, Mary, if you could see that video. I know you're very busy.
Absolutely. Thank you, Lorraine. Thank you so much.
Okay.
I'm going to share my screen. So let me know if you can't hear or if there's any other technical issues, but hopefully this works.
Muslim women in Ireland are being encouraged to get involved in volunteer activities in their local communities. A conference in Dublin today heard how volunteering can help to tackle inaccurate views about Islam, while also helping women to integrate into Irish society.
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. And this place could be much brighter than tomorrow. And there's no need to cry. In this place, you'll feel there's no hurt or sorrow. There are ways to get there. If you care enough for the living, make a little space to make a better place. Heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. Yeah. If you want to know why, there's a love that can and last. Love is strong, only cares for
you. We're out on our journey now tonight. We have the car stocked up, we've portions of hot rice, food, bag for life, survival sheet, so forth and so on. We didn't think we'd see anyone. We weren't out less than 15 minutes and we have already seen two three rough sleepers on the street, which is quite sad. So we'll keep you updated.
Muslim volunteers delivering supplies to homeless and vulnerable people during Storm Emma. It's one of a number of initiatives undertaken by Muslim volunteers in Ireland, including members of the Muslim Sisters of Eire.
So we're back out. He needs rice and chicken marrow again, and there is a man over there sleeping, waving to us. And he was actually asleep, and he's told me that his son and him are both homeless and on the street. He said he has to be in by 10 o'clock to get somewhere to sleep tonight, but his son is after getting a job and he's waiting for him to come, and he's sleeping on the street with him tonight. So alhamdulillah, we've been able to give him a tent tonight. So this is really,
I don't know,
lucky seeing him sleeping.
Aside from its work during Storm Emma, the Muslim Sisters of Eire also hold a weekly soup run on Dublin's O'Connell Street, as well as other activities including visits to sick children in the hospital.
You are all my brothers. Create a world with no fear. Together we'll cry happy tears. See the nations turn their swords into plowshares. We could really get there. If you care enough for the living.
We're just receiving 150 from the brothers from ICCI. 150 portions of food. Still to get drinks out, yeah? Yeah. 150 portions of food. Is it coming with the drinks now? Alhamdulillah, they have donated this week. ICCI, as you can see, all hot and ready to go into our homeless. Mashallah, may Allah reward them.
I am a stay-at-home mom, and MSOE is just a part of my life. It's just my family now. And I love being a part of MSOE because it gives you the opportunity to go out and help others and do things for people who are in need. A lady, I gave her a sleeping bag, and she just took the sleeping bag off me. She walked a few steps and then she came back and she gave me a really big hug. And that was a really heartfelt moment because she was so thankful for just getting the sleeping bag. And I felt like, okay, there's something that you did right now, which was a great feel.
Once I remember, you know, that person, you know, they just put tear in his eyes. He was very depressed, you know, and very quiet, you know. But I said, can I help you with something? And I just randomly, I just gave him stuff, a bag, and I said, is that okay? What else can I do for you? And the tears in his eyes, you know, and say, thank you for being nice to us, you know, and thank you for being there for us. And they said, you know, you guys are angels.
The achievement that stood out for me the most is being in the junior cycle book from this year. Then juniors that started in September will learn about MSOE. There's a religious part of Muslim Sisters of Eire in the book. The youth will now know about MSOE, and it has also give clear what Muslim Sisters is about, not only in the house, you know, cooking and cleaning. We can do other stuff as well.
We're powerful women, mashallah. We have achieved amazing milestones in the past, I'd say 3 years. One of them is the Inspire book, that's the Junior Cert book that we're in. So we're going into the Leaving Cert for this year. There's a book on it for print and for that, the Leaving Cert. So the Junior Cert and the Leaving Cert books we're in. We did the Nationwide Programme on CASA, which was an amazing achievement. Being shortlisted for the Charity Impact Awards, the first ever Muslim organisation to be shortlisted for the Charity Impact Awards. And on top of that, a women's organisation was just amazing. Even though we didn't win, we won in the right that we were shortlisted. To us, that was a clear win for us.
Seeing the homeless every Friday, it actually fills my heart when I get It's like my little piece towards getting there.
It makes me sort of grateful in a way. Like, you know, for things that I have and they don't, and, you know, be able to help them out. You know, for me, it's nothing because I get to go back home with a roof over my head, food to eat on the table. But for them, you know, this is their life out here in the cold. And, you know, really humbles you in a way. And it's a great thing to do.
What motivates me and keeps me going is the realization that no matter how tough our own lives get, there is somebody out there who's facing challenges that are way tougher than ours. Giving back to the society means that you expect no reward, nothing tangible gets sent your way, and no recognition is being given to you. What you do get and your sole reward is the realization that you've made a significant impact on somebody else's life. And that is the essence of my volunteering journey with Muslim Sisters of Eire.
When we all got to know about Muslim Sisters of Eire, we decided to check it out on Good Friday and then to see how it works. So that very Friday when we came around, we were like, how is it? And we were so happy that we're made to serve ourselves, prepare our own traditional food. And alhamdulillah, they love it. And they're always looking forward to it every week. We are all very happy to be part of this.
They are so good. They're so grateful for the food that we give them. It's an eye-opener for us, and that we should be grateful for everything Allah has given us. If everybody had some part in their heart to do something like this, the world would be a better place to live in.
For me and the entire human race, there are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. Heal the world.
To feel the things that we've been involved with during the last 10 years, and inshallah, we look forward to having 10 more. Thank you so much for your support.
Wow, that video always makes me super emotional, doesn't it, Lorraine?
Certainly does when you look at the achievements over the 10 years that we have done, and we haven't even included the pandemic and what we've achieved in the past year, the Ireland Volunteer Awards, the COVID Hero Awards from the Lord Mayor. So, but look, it's women. Women can do anything. Amazing. So I think we're going to end up. I hope you enjoyed that, Mary, that video.
Can I just say that is just incredible. What a whole series of achievements, and the work and the activism is done with such joy. And, you know, people feel that. People feel when something is done with a good heart and with a real compassion for others. It's I salute you. Your work is incredible and I thank you for it, because it's organizations like yours and people like you that hold our communities together and that hold people up when things are hard. So thank you so much, Lorraine, and thank you for showing that video. It's absolutely incredible. Well done, one and all.
Thank you. It hasn't been an easy 10 years, but we've done it. And, you know, when we started this 10 years ago, it was to break this stereotype. And obviously, you know, being a Muslim woman from Coolock and then wearing the shoes of an immigrant, I'm like, okay, we have to do something. And we've done it. And these women are amazing. And they've all nurtured and trained and done so many. And they're Gashka leaders, as I said earlier, as well. And they're doing amazing work. And I really, if I could, I'd take out my hijab to use and go, yoo-hoo, but they're amazing. I ain't taking no hijab off. I struggle to put that on. So, I mean, today is about recognizing the work that each other are doing and the achievements that women have done. And don't forget, even if you're a homemaker and you're at home, you're amazing because you're a mother. And I think when a mother and a wife, if you put so many categories into her, she's a doctor, she's a nurse, she's everything, she's a homemaker, she's everything all in one. So I think we're going to wrap up. Is there any questions there in the inbox, Aisha?
There are no questions, but some very lovely comments, and we thank you. Can't read them all out, but we appreciate your kind words, all the people who've messaged us. Just before we end up, I would like to wholeheartedly thank all our speakers today for taking the time out to join with us and engage with us in this discussion and this wonderful morning. Our heartfelt gratitude to Minister Helen McEntee, Minister Roderic O'Gorman, Senator Eileen Flynn, Mary Lou McDonald, and Yara Alara for joining us today. Special thank you to members of the Gardaí. I know Patrick McGilloway is here, and I can see Garda Rory O'Brien as well, for joining us and supporting us all the time at all our events. And thank you to members of the press who are here with us today. Rory, if you've taken any pictures, feel free to send them our way. The screenshot you took last time was really nice.
Yeah, no problem. I can attempt it here now. All right, can't promise anything, but I'll give it my best shot.
Okay, brilliant. Great. So I think we can all smile for a quick minute while he takes the picture for us.
As many
as would like to turn on their videos for the photo, that would be great.
Sorry, just so many. I've split over two pages, so I'm just trying to get in as many as I can. Will I give you a few seconds for people to turn on cameras?
Yeah, I'm just going to finish my thank yous until then.
Fire away, Aisha.
Special thanks to everyone who has helped in organizing this event. The pandemic has been brutal, but if there is one takeaway gem from this difficult year, it is that together we can get through this. And thank you again for joining us this wonderful morning. Stay safe, take care, and happy International Women's Day.
And put your cameras on now for a big smile.
Okay, so I still have it over two pages, so I'm just going to take two of them and I'll send them on to you. That's perfect. I could probably collage them into the one, so I'll send that on to you later on today.
Great. Right.
You're sure they're not mug shots he's taking?
I'm sure he could take out some mug shots of us somewhere along the line.
I'd be more worried about myself and Pat in these pictures now than anyone else.
I'm telling you. Okay, we thank you all again. Muslim Sisters of Eire wouldn't be where they are today without the amazing support of the public. The Irish public are just amazing. I actually went yesterday horse riding for the first time, and the guy that was helping me do the horse riding was a dub man all the way in Wicklow. That just had me 5 kilometres. Oops. Anyway, he was talking about Muslim Sisters of Eire. And he was talking about the amazing work even down there that they are known about. And he said, you know, I was saying about how much the Irish people are amazing and charitable. And, you know, all that I can do is from Muslim Sisters of Eire to all of you is thank you all for the support. You are just amazing. And here's to another 10 years and here's to changing the world, Mary. So take care and God bless you all. And thank you all so much. Okay, that's it.
Right, would you like the committee to stay behind, Lorraine? Or if anybody wants to say something, we can just wind up in a quick minute.
I just need a 2 minute break. I'll be back to you in 2 minutes. Should you want to come back to me in 2 minutes as well?
No, it's all right. We can wind up while you're gone. I'll wait for you for the committee meeting. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. Feel free to log off as I'll leave the Zoom on for the committee to join in a quick meeting.